Welcome back, fans. Deadweight take out game number one pretty comfortably, Lynx, and they're looking to continue that dominance in game number two up against Avant-Garde. Avant-Garde just, you know, at the start it was relatively close, but the longer and longer that game went, the more and more disparate was the lead between those two teams.
Deadweight were just able to completely snowball in that game, and just everyone, especially HS, was able to get online, able to get that items and just amount a such a high level and build lead that there was just no way for Avant-Garde to come back and just accept their defeat.
We head into picks and bans here. Very interested to see what Deadweight will play here. Took game number one fairly easily, I want to say. So game number two, I think they might try out something, you know, a little bit funky, a little bit, you know, off meta or just out of the ordinary for themselves. Test it out as they feel like, you know, this is a team that we can achieve something like that against. Raijin, though, a very standard ban, is going to be the first ban here for Deadweight.
Yes, even though Deadweight are the number one team, they still just don't want to deal with Raijin. We've seen him do incredible things at both DreamHack and International Lions, and even here in Australia. You just do not want him in your games if you want to win. Otherwise, he is going to burst you down, he is Thunder Crash on you, and he is going to kill you.
One Yu now banned away from Avant-Garde. They don't want to be stealing, I should say, that healing. Susano banned away from Deadweight as well. So these are two very standard bans coming out from Deadweight thus far, just denying very strong picks to Avant-Garde. Athena, though, banned away from Avant-Garde rather than trying to retain that for themselves.
Yes, they can know that Weave can actually play a very mean Athena, so if they let her through the pick and bans, it could be possible that Deadweight could get it. However, Deadweight straight away going for one of their staple gods, Kabrakan. Shred is going to be very, very happy.
Kabrakan just does so much damage, as well as that, it denies a lot of picks to the opposition. You know, even Kabrakan is picked up very early on in the draft, it denies it the opportunity to go mages that don't have many escapes. You know, think of your Zeus's, think of your Poseidon's. You know, Sol to a certain extent, although she can get away relatively easily. A Nemesis and Ho-Yi picked up here. So the Nemesis to me, again, is odd with the Kabrakan pickup. You put down those walls as Kabrakan, it's going to be very difficult to get away from. The Ho-Yi, though, makes sense for Rob Diggity, something he's comfortable on, something that he can really compete on.
I think actually Liquid Renegade is kind of smart for drafting the Nemesis, because what you can do is you can put the Divine Judgment, take away 50% projection, take away a bunch of his health, and since he is standing still, combine that with the Ho-Yi, just throw down some Suns, and if Kabrakan accidentally misplaces that Tectonic Shift, that could spell disaster for Deadweight. However, Shred is extremely good when it comes to positioning like the rest of his team, and I don't see Shred making such easy mistakes.
Alright, Tier picked up here for El Chuckles. I actually just tweeted out a video of Shred's Tier, so that's why Shred doesn't play that, but I'm very interested to see how he plays against a Tier. So the Tier is actually pretty good against the Kabrakan. When the Kabrakan's down in the Tremors, you can use that Fearless Cleave, Power Cleave combination to get him out of a lot of that damage. So I'm very interested to see what El Chuckles can do on this character. Arnher now picked up by Avant-Garde.
Yes, the Arnher ban is straight away just targeting HS. They saw him play it against Pandemonium and they were like, we do not want to deal with the Arnher. Arnher is an extremely strong early god, and since Weave has gone that aggressive Bacchus again, they're just like, we can't afford to have HS get such a massive lead like last game.
Ulla now banned away by Avant-Garde, Sobek banned away from Deadweight, Kepri as well taken away by Deadweight, so limiting perhaps Gruff's God pool. He does play Ares and actually used to be very good at that character back about a year ago when he was a support main as well. Very difficult for other teams to deal with his Ares. Instead though, he's going to get Akumba. Now, Akumba provides a lot of soft CC. He's got a root, he's got a mesmerize. The only hard CC really comes out of his ultimate. However, he does output a lot of damage and can be a very disruptive force in teamfights.
I feel like this is kind of a very unsynergistic pick simply because you're kind of forcing someone out of the teamfight. When from what I can see from Avant-Garde, especially if they picked a Ho-Yi, you want to be doing as much damage with everyone inside the sun. So if you knock someone into the air, you're essentially allowing them to be damage immune and like wait out the sun to period. However, Fenrir and Apollo will be your final picks for Deadweight.
Sol as well, the last pick for Avant-Garde. So the Fenrir pick is a little strange to me. I said I thought Deadweight might play something a little funky here. It's not too funky, that's not really what I meant. But what's strange about it is that in OC, no one's ever really found too much success with a Fenrir. We saw it at the LAN, both Pandemonium and Tainted Minds played it, and in the games they played it, they both lost and were both bottom damaged with that Fenrir in the jungle. So, you know, Fenrir just seems to be a character that in OCE people struggle to play with. It's the same with Thor. You know, when teams have picked Thor in OCE, it's, you know, it's rarely won, or if it's won, it hasn't really been a huge influential factor in the game.
However, Deadweight, as I've mentioned before, are a team based entirely on putting people out of position. And if you want a god who can take someone out of position, Fenrir is your god. You essentially pick someone up, throw them into the Lightning Storm, a Detonate Charge, or a Belly Flop, or a Kabrakan Ultimate, and you can force people like Mouse, who usually has that damage immunity, to get away from let's say, this team fight, and then force them to really uncomfortable positions, or force out that all-important purification for that 180 seconds.
Start of the game here, we can see the Agony hasn't rushed a purple pot here, instead gone for an Imperial Helmet start, so expecting a lot of rotations from Liquid Renegade out of the jungle, just trying to play safe for himself here in the mid lane. Given that the amount of slows that can come out of a Nemesis, it's very difficult for Azus to get away, given that none of his abilities are escapes.
Not to mention the fact also Sol has also the slow on the Stellar Burst, and with the fact that, as you said, he has no dashes or escapes of any form, he has to play very safe. Luckily, he can easily clear lane, level 1, just with an Aegis Assault, simply because you can basically bounce your auto attacks and hit all 6 minions in the way without having to worry too much about using that purple pot.
So although Mouse does have a purple pot, so he's going to have a lot of clear here early in the game. I'm very interested to see how he builds this soul. There's kind of two schools of thought on this one. Just build it on these kind of standard mage lines, or build it more of an auto attacker. Gruff here actually taken pretty low by HS and Weave. Rob Diggity gets some damage back onto Weave, but the healing poach is going to be enough. HS dashing forward here, looking for some more damage, but Gruff backs under his own tower and is going to be fine. But however, over on the right-hand side, Chuckles taken pretty low here. Shred stuns him out, only good at solo, picks up first blood for Deadweight.
And now, since Ogre has indeed gone into the red plot start, he is completely validated at that start. We're starting to see a lot more of this meta. A lot of people are actually picking up either the red or purple pot in a multitude of roles. And essentially, if you're able to get a kill while picking up that red pot, essentially that allows you to snowball with more levels, and essentially that 450 gold, you now got it back, and you are ready to go into this mid game with an advantage.
And that's so unfortunate for El Chuckles as well. Akin's already a big lane bully. Now that he's down in experience and gold, it's just going to make it even harder for him to contest against this Kabrakan.
And with Kabrakan now getting a buff last couple of patches to his passive, allowing him to get more protections, as well as the Mark of the Vanguard change, he's just so potent. As you can see, El Chuckles already super low under tower, and due to the fact Tia has pretty weak early lane clear and very mana hungry, without his mana buff, he is going to be hurting a lot early on.
Only good at solos made a rotation around here as well, looking and waiting for El Chuckles to walk out of his tower and into the middle of the lane. He's doing so now, he's getting baited in here. Shred stuns him out here, there's the Tremors, only good at solo over the top. Brutalize comes through, El Chuckles still alive somehow, Fearless is under the tower, only good at solo, just barely missing out on another kill there.
Yes, the one of the major pros of Tier, however, even though I mentioned a lot of cons just then, the Power Cleave is a nice instant heal. You can just get so much heal up, and then you have the two dashes to get away. However, Liquid Renegade may not be so lucky, as Ogre is going after him and is able to pick up the kill.
Sacrifices his own life there for a kill, but I know only good at solo, and he's going to be calling worth on that one. He's definitely hungry for some kills in this game, and in all the games that he plays there, he plays in the OPL. Shred here with just the Mark of the Vanguard start. You can see the strength of Power Pots, given the amount of damage he's done early in this game, 1400 damage thus far.
Yes, that is no surprise at all, especially against someone like T, as I mentioned, he's going to be trying to keep himself sustained in lane, and all Shred has to do is just constantly keep applying that damage. Every time he hits a Seismic Crush or a Refraction Shield, he's just slowly whittling away at El Chuckles, and even though El Chuckles doesn't have health in multi-pots, there's only so much you can sustain at level 4 compared to a level 6 Kabrakan.
Looking at the solo lane though, Shred doesn't have any mana here. Chuckles looking to box him a little bit towards the mid camps though. Mouse taking to about 50% HP here, disappears away from only good at solo. I was talking before how this Fenrir is never really, you know, played to its full extent here in OCE, but only good at solo since he'd make it worse. Agony absolutely bursted down here from Avant-Garde. Only good at solo gets the ultimate off, looking for the return kill onto Mouse, and he gets it, and now he's just trying to run away from Liquid Renegade and El Chuckles. Shred is rotating in, only good at solo over the top of the wall, and manages to get out.
Were they actually able to steal the speed buff? Because even then, that doesn't really matter. They were able to get two kills off that. That was a mad. And there comes the Tectonic Shift out from Shred.
Shred trying to pick up a kill here. I don't think he got the blue buff. He didn't, but he's trying to find the kill onto El Chuckles, who just barely actually manages to get away from his way with his life there. Look at Renegade, almost body blocked him into continual Tectonic. Tremors there. And that would have been the end of the life of El Chuckles. looking towards the duo lane now. Did HS? Yeah, HS stole away the red buff as well. So that's something I wanted to talk about. We've just seen, you know, three consecutive buff invades from Deadweight, and this is very much the style that they like to play. And this is something that a lot of OCE teams need to adapt, or are adapting and learning to, is when you have even the smallest advantage, you need to push it. And pushing it doesn't mean, you know, fighting people in lane, trying to find one-on-one kills. It means taking away their jungle. HS now being aggressive on, there's the Sunbreaker ultimate. Liquid Renegade is here as well. There's the Mez from HS, but he dashes into the sun and falls down to Rob Diggity. Equal kills us for Avant-Garde. You know, not going quietly into the night here.
No, and especially thanks that they were able to actually draft Rob Diggity's Favorite God, Hu Yi, and now putting up their stand. They're like, we are Avant-Garde, we may be fifth on the ladder, but we aren't out. We are a pro league team, we deserve to be. And there comes a tier ult from Chuckles.
Looking for Agony, who's already fallen down once, but he manages to get away under his tower. Liquid Renegade looking for Weave. Weave, though, just jumps straight over the wall back into his tower. He's going to be fine. That is one thing that is going to be an issue for Avant-Garde, is securing kills here. A lot of escapes or dead weight on a lot of their characters. You know, HS has got his Across the Skies, he's got a dash. Weave's got to jump over the wall. Only got a solo's got to jump. Shred's got a lot of hard CC to run away and some extra movement speed. Speaking of Shred, though, taking a lot of damage here as the Divine Judgment comes through. Root from Gruffs keeps him in place. He's just going to do Tremors and try and deal as much damage as he can before he dies. But El Chuckles picks up the kill. Avant ahead in something for the first time in this series, even though it's just kills.
And now we actually have a little bit between the two solo lanes. We can actually see El Chuckles has actually been able to pick up a kill. Shred was only able to be a part of the assist from Ogre. However, over in the mid lane, the Lightning Storm does come down.
Mouse manages to separate nicely there. The Brutalize, though, in combination with the Detonate, picks up the kills. Kills are even again. Diggity looking for only got a solo, who jumps yet again over the wall. El Chuckles looking for Weave along with Liquid Renegade here. Weave down about 50% HP, uses the Intoxicate to try and get the rest of the members of Avant-Garde away. And Agony throws out some nice damage there with a Chain Lightning and saves the life of his support.
Yes, I'm really liking Avant's playstyle this game. Essentially, what you said about matching the aggression, I think Avant-Garde are doing a really good job to try and match Deadweight's aggression. And if anything, they are playing more of their own style of game. A lot of teams fall into the sort of trap against Deadweight where they are kind of forced into Deadweight's game. If you can basically force Deadweight to play your way, force them, you can actually be more of your playstyle, that's when you start to see teams actually do well against Deadweight. And Avant-Garde are doing a very good job so far to try and actually keep the pace.
Graphs, though, still tell a tale that spells out Deadweight the lead. 1,400 experience, 1,300 gold is the difference between these two teams. So, you know, the kills might be even, but Deadweight has still managed to take away buffs, has still managed to secure mid-camps and the like. Avant-Garde need to do a better job at that if they want to stay contentious in this game.
However, this deficit is a lot less than the last game, and 1,000 XP and gold is nothing in terms of Smite. On Gold Fury can essentially turn the tides around, and Deadweight are looking to take that Gold Fury.
They've got the best secure in the game that's viable at the moment in the Zeus. The Isis ult can be a little bit better, but it's very hard to play that at the moment, very difficult to time. Zeus, you just press three, basically, and it's secure. El Chuckles here uses the Lawbringer over the wall. There's a fight now around the mid-camps here. Chuckles gets a Fearless onto Shred, but Shred still has his ultimate available, looking to wall off Avant-Garde here, but a slow from Mouse manages to stop that aggression for now. But Across the Skies comes HS, only got a solo over the wall, picks up one kill onto El Chuckles, looking for another one here. Gruff falls down to Agony, and now it is a 5-on-3 situation in favor of Deadweight.
Yes, that is exactly what Deadweight wanted. That they wanted Avant-Garde to go for the engagement there. And he saw Shred there first, used that tectonic shift. The Fearlesses were down, all the abilities were down, and all Deadweight had to do was just drop the Lightning Storm, use the Fenrir stun, and now they're going back into engage on Avant.
Only got a solo, picks himself up another kill here on a killing spree. Gold Fury started back up here by Deadweight. As I mentioned, they do have the Zeus secure. Not really much steal potential coming out from Avant-Garde unless Rob Diggity can get a double bounce, but only got a solo, and Shrek turned their attentions to him. The sun's come down, but Deadweight smartly just leashed the Gold Fury. Don't allow those suns to do anything. Gruff, Liquid Renegade looking as well to disrupt the Gold Fury, and they successfully do so. Deadweight just back away.
Ogre has just been doing an incredible job on this Fenrir, 6-1 and 2. And a lot of the problems that Fenrir can have is if you don't snowball, you just become an ult bot. But as we've been seeing in this game, Ogre's just been able to dish out so much damage simply because he's been able to get so far ahead. He's literally one level above every single member of Avant-Garde.
Yeah, Chuckles just hit level 10 to level it up there, but still, incredible job for only good at solo thus far. Taking a look at the graphs yet again, we can see the lead again just been steadily climbing in favor of deadweight. 2,700 experience in the lead to 2,200 gold in the lead. The kills as well, 8-4 in favor of deadweight.
However, this is not a dire situation. Vanguard can easily turn this around. They just need to play a little bit more smart in these team fights. They need to understand the absolute power that is Ragnarok, Tectonic Shift, and the Lightning Storm. Just all these game-changing ultimates that they really need to keep an eye on, and then use that Divine Judgment to pick off the tanky Shred and make him super weak. Just get rid of any sort of protection. Allow them to actually try and whittle him away.
El Chuckles here in the solo lane. Wants to use the Lawbringer. Barely alive. He only got it solo. Fearless as he goes underneath the tower. Good Tectonic Rift Shift, I should say, from Shred. But Liquid Renegade picks up. Only good at solo. Up in the air. Goes Shred from the Kumbakana ultimate. But he is so tanky. Look at all the damage he's dealing out to Liquid Renegade. Only good at solo there. Shut down by Avant Garde.
Yes, that was a bit weird from Oki there. You kind of saw him like he was. I think he had like two minds on a decision. He was like, should I go back in or should I leave? And eventually he kind of half-heartedly did one of them, and that's how we kind of got caught out by the Supernova. Shred wanted to try and catch the Liquid Renegade with a nice Seismic Crush.
Can't find it though. Liquid Renegade manages to get out alive here. Shred backing in the solo lane. Hatchis there did use his Across the Skies. I'm not quite sure why. I just saw him flying around on the minimap, but Avant-Garde need to note that ultimate is down. If they can force something in the mid or solo lane while that ultimate is down, it's going to mean one less member of Deadweight is there to help out his team.
And not to mention, since there's no Yanis currently on the side of Deadweight compared to last game, don't have that global rotation power if the Across the Skies is down. That's the only way for Apollo to actually get around the place. If he doesn't have that, he is just going to be stuck in the lane split pushing.
Mouse there knocked off by Weave, who's rooted in place by Gruff. Good Salvation will keep him at about 50% HP. Mouse forced to use the Disapparate as well. He's not going to have that available. Shred in the mid lane gets Fearless up into the wall, but only going to solo across the wall. Good Tectonic Shift there from Shred. Keeps the Liquid Renegade in place, and Weave secures the kill with a Belly Flop. Intoxicate used onto Gruff, who's forced to dash away as well. All of Deadweight super healthy at the moment due to the double Salvation that they have. Only going to solo, looks for Gruff, picks him up with the ultimate, and now Chuckles looking for Only Good at solo here as the rest of Deadweight is looking for the tower.
However, Shred is just sticking around with that Seismic Crush. I'm going to be the wall between you and Deadweight. You're not getting anywhere near the team. We saw in that team fight, Shred did a great job just catching Liquid Renegade just as he was trying to get off that dash to get away. And he was just caught into the wall. He dashed into the wall and Deadweight secured the Gold Fury.
Rob Diggity as well, taken very low there by Shred, who's done a beautiful job in both of these games of zoning away from objectives for his team. That's something OCE teams a lot of times struggle with, is this zoning kind of job around objectives. It's really something that's... we've seen a big shift in OCE Smite from Worlds, and this is pretty much what everyone that's had any esports experience expected to happen. You know, team goes overseas for the first time, learns a whole lot, comes back and influences the whole scene, teaches them a whole new style of play. And we've even seen that, like Pandemonium. They were the number one team last split, and by a pretty fair margin as well. They were the number one team all of last year. They went overseas, they learned a lot, they come back. Other teams have learned from this now, and now other teams have gotten better, and Pandemonium's not even sitting on top of the ladder.
Yes, it's surprising to see how, as you said, it's more of a good thing than a bad thing for Pandora. It's just, as you said, the scene has adapted. It's become much stronger and more competitive. And that's really what we want to see to bring the most excitement out of the scene.
As well as that, you said it is a good thing for Pandemonium, actually, because now they have better competition to play against. And now they've got better opportunities to improve themselves.
Yes, improvement, like, that's the most important thing. We saw kind of a little bit last year, the teams were starting to get a little bit stagnated, but now the floodgates have opened, and you can see teams like Deadweight have been able to rise from the top and just take the field and really prove to be the best in OCE.
In the solo lane, El Chuckles, Fearless's Shred under the tower here, only got it solos here. Oh my goodness, look at that damage. Chuckles bursted down there, only got a solo, claims himself another scalp. Liquid Renegade is here along with Gruff. There is the Ragnarok ultimate up into the sky. Ghost Shred, Divine Judgment user, only got a solo, but Shred manages to keep his jungle alive for now using that Salvation. Here is the rest of Deadweight, and now they're looking for blood. Gruff intoxicated, only got a solo, looking for the kill here. Can he find it? The Kuma passive is popped. Shred, though, credited with the kill. Mouse now using the ultimate. Shred hunting after the mid laner, doesn't find the stun, but Deadweight find the tier 1 tower on the right hand side.
And now Deadweight, if they want, they could even maybe look to try and take this tier 2 as Avant is forced to back, and the only one remaining is Mouse on very low mana. And however, the teleport is used by Tia, and Tia is now rotated back into the solo lane.
Three men from Deadweight looking for this tower here. Shred rotating in as well. There's the Lightning Storm ultimate and Mouse deleted from the map. El Chuckles uses the ultimate there. Weave and Shred under the tower, tanking up the damage. Only got a solo. Brutalizes El Chuckles looking for the kill. There's a Tectonic Shift again, but El Chuckles flips over the wall with the Lawbringer ultimate, and now Deadweight forced to run away.
However, over in the dual lane though, HS is not backing off. He was able to solo Rob Diggity and using that across the skies to get out to safety just in case there's another rotation. And now we can actually look to try and take this tier one as it's super low. Apollo is the split push king when it comes to ADCs.
Can I get a CGS soloed in chat? That was very impressive there from HS. Soloing out a Ho-Yu, who is the best 1v1 god in the game. Soloing him out under his own tower, no less. Very, very great play there from HS247.
That is partially due to the fact that Apollo also is an extremely good boxing hunter, as well as the fact he has picked up an Ikavile, so that will allow him to box better. However, over in the solo lane, we see El Chuckles just getting absolutely bursted down by Ogre.
Another kill there. They got a solo 10-2 at the moment. Back to the ADC thing, though. Rob Diggity has got a Soul Eater, so he's got Lifesteal, and he's got that Soul Eater passive. That is huge in 1v1 situations. So, yes, the Ikavile is nice, but without any Lifesteal, it's super impressive for HS to have won that 1v1.
And now Deadweight are actually looking to try and steal the speed buff, which is going an engagement onto Avant.
Liquid Renegade picked up in the Ragnarok ultimate, and only got a solo, brutalizes another kill here. Gruff Nux only got a solo up into the air, and Deadweight get the speed buff. Mouse disapparated, but he can't hide for long from only got a solo. There's the jump. Now he's looking for the brutalized kill. Good Tectonic Shift there. Only got a solo, gets himself another kill. Lightning Storm ultimate used by Agony here. Only got a solo, has got himself a double kill. Rob Diggity trying to get some damage off here. Doesn't find the triple bounce. Only got a solo, looking for the triple. Not gonna find it. Oh, he jumps over the wall. Brutalized. Can he secure the kill? The Sanctuary is popped by Rob Diggity, who manages to keep himself alive just for now. The Belch, though, takes him down along with Shred. And now the Tier 2 tower in the mid lane is the target of Deadweight's aggression here. Avant-Garde, it is all falling down around them. It is 20-5. Read the scores. Back not too long ago, Lynx, it was 4-4. These teams were even, but Deadweight just snowballing like crazy.
Well, it's just Ogre has been playing out of his mind. 13-2-6 in 16 minutes. He's basically got a kill every minute. He has just been constantly going super aggressive, using that Void Shield, using all his abilities so well. And since he's now such a high level ahead of the rest of Avant-Garde, he just keeps snowballing and snowballing. And now HS able to finally take that tier 2 in the duo lane.
Mouse is here though, along with Gruff. Good Renegade in the area. There's the Divine Judgment. HS tries to dash away, but is mesmerized out. HS up into the skies he goes, and he gets away from the damage. That's the best part about Apollo. When you look like you're in danger, you just press that 4 button and fly on out of there.
And that's all he has to do. He literally just needs to take towers, even though he just hasn't been a massive part of the team fights like he was last game on the Hoot Yee. That's what you do as Apollo. You split push, you tank objectives, and you just give your team free experience and gold. And now Ogre looking to go in on a Mouse.
Looking for some more damage here. Mouse manages to separate. There's the Ragnarok ultimate, so only got solo can look for Mouse. Picks him up with the ultimate, gets himself a kill. He is 14-2. Is he chasing the kills record? If he gets the 19 kills, he's got himself the record. Rob Diggity knocked up into the air, taken down by Agony. Only got a solo, looking for some more kills in this one. Gruff very low. Agony's got himself a double kill. Only good at solo though, keeping on going, looking for El Chuckles. Can he find him? Liquid Renegade doing the best he can to keep his teammate alive, but puts himself in a bad position. He is Nemesis though, so he sprints away, dashes away, keeps himself alive for now. 14-2, only good at solo. Proving he is not only good at solo.
Yes, I think we proved that at the very beginning of this clip when we saw him play jungle. We see him play Ao Kuang, Kali, all these really hyper aggressive junglers. And even now in the Spenry, he's just been playing the exact same way he already has. And now we see him pick up another kill onto El Chuckles.
15 kills for only good at solo. Mouse, though, trying to defend his left hand side Phoenix. It's just not happening for you, my friend. Liquid Renegade dashing away. So actually stuns out. Only good at solo there. Actually, I think that was Gruff with the mesmerized shred there. Cops the Divine Judgment. Just going to run away, however. Salvation's not up for another 30 seconds here for Deadweight. They don't even have the Fire Giant yet and are already pressuring down Phoenixes. This is very impressive. Graphs read 18,000 experience, 12,000 gold in favor of the boys in blue. Actually, they're both in blue, so in favor of Deadweight.
Only one gold theory has been taken this entire game. All that stuff is literally just because they've been able to get so many kills and so many objectives, and now they are starting the gold theory. However, they look to re-engage onto Gruff.
Gruff trapped in there by the Tectonic Shift, gets a good mesmerize up into the air. Does he fling? Only good at solo for a passive pop. Mouse trying to keep his support alive here, but only good at solo. It's relentless. Agony, oh my goodness, stole that kill away from Only Good at Solo. He won't be happy about that one. Mouse knocked up here, no chance to get away. Agony's got himself a double kill. And now Rob Diggity trying to defend in this mid lane. Deadweight looking back at the Gold Fury.
At this point, I don't really think it matters if Ogre gets any more kills. He's level 18 with 15 kills. I think he can kind of share the love, share the kills for Agony, get him a couple more items, and Zeus can really come online.
You don't know Only Good at Solo. He rage quits out of TeamSpeak when you steal kills in casuals, so he's definitely going to be raging at that one.
Oh, but still, like, you gotta be happy. I don't think he can be mad. He's just literally getting to play like a donkey. I just get to pick up all the different gods, play around with them, brutalize them, do anything I want to them, and they are my plaything. There's nothing Avant can do right now.
Raph's still heavily in favor of Deadweight in this one, as we're about to hit 20 minutes in this game, and the incredible lead that Deadweight has, that is so, relatively speaking, early in the game, is incredible to see.
Well, we're talking about such an early relative lead. We've seen Weave has already gone into a Soul Reaver as his third item. He doesn't even need Hard Ward or any other magical protections. He knows all he needs to do is just belly flop and intoxicate, and Avant will merely fall to his might.
Alrighty, we can see Deadweight now pushing up on the right-hand side, looking to take this tier 2 tower, but looking to catch out anyone along the way as they take a route along the back of that tower. They're not even bothering with minions here. They're all so tanky, they can effectively do this one. HS isn't even here. He's still pushing on the left-hand side, trying to force fire minions under the tower. The amount of power that Deadweight has at the moment means they can still do this tower without him. HS now rotating towards the middle lane, now towards the right-hand side. Tier 2 tower falls. Deadweight looking to press their advantage, and Only Good at Solo. I could tell he's hunting for some more kills.
Even under this Phoenix, Avantgarde are not safe. They need to be extremely careful. One more misplay with one Phoenix already down. This could already be the game if they really wanted to, because Deadweight have such a massive advantage. However, Deadweight just lying to play it a little bit more safe now they have such a commanding lead, and they possibly could be looking for Fire Giant.
It makes sense. The left-hand side Phoenix is down. Fire minions are pushing up that way. If they start it now, they've got the burst potential to take it down. Only got a solo. Looking for a kill here onto Gruff. Fred, though, takes him down. And now, HS247 up in the sky. Is he looking to go crashing down onto Mouse here? No, he's heading back towards the Fire Giant. Only got a solo. Going to be playing the zone game here. Pushing up the wave on the right-hand side. Avantgarde looking to collapse onto him. Fire Giant just being started up now by Deadweight, but Only got a solo in between three members here. Looking for Mouse. There's a Divine Judgment coming out from Liquid Renegade. Only got a solo. Sprints away. Weave trying to peel for his jungler here. He does manage to get away. Rob Diggity does a lot of damage here to Agony, but gets bursted here by the combination of Shred and Only got a solo. There's the Brutalize, but the Sanctuary keeps Rob Diggity alive for now. Only got a solo. Doesn't stun him out, and Rob Diggity just barely manages to get away with his life.
Rob Diggity actually also nearly tried to steal the Fire Giant there, using that Sunbreaker to try and see if he could actually steal the Fire Giant away from HS. However, Deadweight, very smart, they just leashed it away and making that ult a massive waste. And even though they weren't able to get the kill onto HS, the wave was able to push off the Deadweight. And even though the Phoenix is respawned, a lot of Fire Minions are very close to that Phoenix. And if Deadweight wants, they can just look to pressure this tier 2 with just Apollo alone, use his ultimate, get a free Phoenix, get some gold, and then go straight for Fire Giant.
The biggest problem I could see at the moment on Avantgarde is Gruff, and nothing against him as a player, but just in this game currently 0-7, only level 11, no magical protections online at the moment. So Shred and Agony are going to be doing so much damage to him at this point in the game. He's not going to be able to play that frontline tank role that his team needs him to play.
Well, the problem is he's just been killed so often. Like, Ogre has literally been making a beeline for him with that Ragnarok, and Gruff now engaging, using the Groggy Strike to try and even out the odds, but Fire Giant has already been taken.
Shred doing so much damage to him here, only got a solo, gets it down into the passive. He's trying to last at him here to just pick up the kill. He gets it. 16 kills now for the jungler on Deadweight. All the Phoenixes are up for Avantgarde, but the left-hand side one is low, 50% HP, and less protections due to it being taken down before. A Fire Giant on every member of Deadweight bar Shred.
Yes, and even though Shred won't be able to get Fire Giant, really the main person you want to get it on is HS, because all HS needs to do is just get that Audacity passive online, and run onto a Phoenix, and suddenly a Phoenix was there and a magic trick will happen and it will no longer be there.
Weave looking for the belly flop, doesn't find it, but Chuckles takes a lot of damage here. The very low HS picks up the kill. Liquid Renegade trying to get away here. Only good at solo, picks up the kill with the Ragnarok ultimate. He is two away from the record. He's hunting after Mouse now, trying to get an 18th kill on the board. Agony though picks up the kill with the detonate. Middle Phoenix falls, a Deadweight now looking to press into the Titan pit. And they're trying to find either Rob Diggity or Gruff here.
They don't even need to find, they could literally just go for that time. However, they play it smart. They know this Phoenix is already extremely low. Head down the Phoenix for the second time, and Gruff trying his best, but Ogre doesn't allow it. Titan falls after a surrender boat. 18 kills to Ogre, just one away, but still an absolutely valiant performance. Deadweight take the series 2-0.
Incredible performance there. It happened like you said, Lynx, in the first game. You know, they feel out their opponent, try and find out their draft strategy, try and find out their playstyle, and then the second game really go hard and take them down in a very one-sided contest. We're going to be joined here in just a moment by the captain and jungler of Deadweight, only good at solo. Here he is, the New Zealand jungler, Ogre. How are you doing, my friend?
I'm good. Just feel quite tilted because my scumbag team stole like 5 kills, so I didn't get my record again.
That was gonna be my next question. How does it feel that Agony took away 2 of the kills that could have given you the record?
Yeah, I don't know. It feels bad, especially since my 19-3 Loki game hasn't been like officially recorded on the record chart. So yeah, there were a bunch of kills that people lost that just didn't annoy me at that point.
I told you, Lynx, I told you he gets annoyed at that.
Yeah, so mad.
So thus far in the season, we're halfway through, you have yet to record a loss. It's got to be feeling for all you guys who, you know, as your name implies, you're all castaways from other teams.
I guess, but I like to say we're the best of the castaways. makes us feel better. It's like the best of the disbands.
So Avant-Garde, you know, in that first game, they at the start of both of those games looked to be, you know, matching you quite well. Was there anything that you kind of picked up from them that you knew you needed to do in order to, you know, get yourselves ahead? Or was it just a case of, you know, wait out till this point in the game and then we'll come online and then we can really win?
I think when it just gets to the point of the game where we start grouping and stuff, we just dominate. Well, we have been dominating just because people listen to calls. Well, they're getting better at listening to calls, and we just like work well together now.
So you're saying if you play together as a team, you will crush?
Yeah, and if you play as individuals, you'll be crushed or something like that.
Yeah, shoutouts to Kiki Yamio. Linksclone, any questions for our guest?
So what was the call behind the Fenrir draft in game number 2? Because usually we see gods like Alkwong and Kali be picked up by you. Fenrir, you don't really see as a hyper carry. You see him kind of like in the middle.
Yeah, well, it's, we played it like once this week in scrims, and I said Fenrir was a god I didn't want to play because he did no damage, but then we go to Trusty Horizon, and he gives me a nice Fenrir build, and I'm tanky and I kill people, so I decided I would try it, and works well with the Zeus, because you just set up for the Zeus, and they die. So, yeah, I didn't want to pick it ever, this entire OPL, but people convinced me to play it, which was good, I guess.
Alright, with that, any shoutouts you'd like to give, Ogre?
Shout out to Rogue Diggity for aegising my Brutalize, like, every time, so I didn't get kills. not really. Just shout out to the team for taking my kills.
Alright, thank you very much, Only Good at Solo. That's going to do it here from us in the SMITE OPL for week number 5. We are now halfway through the split, guys. It's gone by so incredibly fast. Come back next week, Saturday, 6 p.m. Australian Eastern Standard Time for some more OPL action. But for all of us here at CGTV SMITE, thank you very much for tuning in and bearing with us through technical difficulties throughout the weekend. We'll see you next time.